in the name of heavenly music. And the reason I use that word heavenly is because I believe for this next song, which is the last song before I take a little break, I believe I did get some divine inspiration. Now, I was writing songs from the age of 15 or 16, and most of them, you know, you might say, oh, well, I don't remember that one. And that wasn't nothing special about that. But something special was coming through me. The muse, if there is such a thing, was speaking through me, was communicating. Call it divine inspiration. I think it was a little touch of God trying to help me out here. So I wrote a song called Handbags and Gladrags. Yeah. I suppose if I take you right back to the beginning, I might have been indirectly inspired by a Jimi Hendrix record called The Wind Cried Mary. And if you listen to that record, there is a guitar solo that is not unlike this piano riff. And so on and so on. If you listen to that record, there's something in there. Now, that subliminally was working through me. And I find myself playing that riff, which people who know their country music will know a guy called Floyd Kramer. Floyd Kramer plays, this is called country licks, you know. And I can play that style. Manfred couldn't play it to save his bloody life. I played the song to them. They didn't know what it was about. I said, what is that? And in fact, we did that with the Manfreds on a Julie Felix show on BBC Two. They didn't connect up with the song, but I didn't even know what I was writing, and I started singing this. Ever seen a blind man cross the road, trying to make the other side? I thought, where's that come from? What's that about? I didn't know. Second line. Ever seen a young girl growing old, trying to make herself a bride? What's that about? And then something, I thought, what is this? And I then came up with a rhyme. Handbags and the glad rags. I thought, oh, I like that, because I need one more rhyme. Now, this might be bringing me my songwriting down to earth. What other song word rhymes with handbags and glad rags? Ah, granddads, yes. And that's how the song came about. Well, anyway, I had written the song, and I got a call from Andrew Oldham, who is the producer and the manager of the Rolling Stones. But he had parted company with them. This is 1967. Formed a new record label called Immediate, and on that label was a young soul singer called Chris Farlow. Chris Farlow had just come off a number one hit with Out of Time, which Jagger and Richard had written. So he said, he and his partner Tony Calder said, look, Mike, we're here, you're writing songs, you're frustrated with the Manfreds, do you want to come and work for us, write and produce for some of our artists? I said, yes, I'd love to. So I played Chris Farlow some songs, and he fell for this song. Well, 2 to 3 weeks later, Andrew called me again. He said, we've just signed another soul singer. I said, what's his name? He said, his name is Rod Stewart. This is 1968. Nobody had heard of Rod Stewart in 1968. Not a sausage. He was in the Jeff Beck group. He had been in Steam Packet with Long John Baldry, but the record-buying public had never heard of Rod Stewart. But they signed him up. Said, do you want to go and check him out? I said, yes. I went down, heard him with the Jeff Beck group, with Ronnie Wood on bass, Mick Waller on drums, Jeff Beck, of course, on guitar, Rod Stewart hiding behind his amplifier, coming out very shy and nervously. And I thought, what a knockout voice. So I had Rod round to the house, and I said, Rod, here's some songs. He immediately picked up Handbags and Gladrags. I said, well, you can't do that song because I'm recording it with Chris Farlow, and we can't have two rival versions. So I persuaded him to sing another song that I'd written called Little Misunderstood, which is a collector's item now. Sold all of 28 copies at the time. But so anyway, Rod and I struck a deal. He said, I'll sing that other song you want me to sing, Little Misunderstood, if you let me sing Handbags and Gladrags when I get my first album deal. That was a whole year later. Rod came round to the house one day in 1969, unannounced. I happened to be in. Oh, Rod, come in. He said, I've got the record deal, and I want to record Handbags and Gladrags with you on piano tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. But I want you to come up with a new arrangement. And this, as I say, is the last song. I'm sorry if I'm overstaying my welcome, but I've got to tell you the background. I stayed up all night. I cannot write a note of music. I can play music, but I can't tell you a B-flat from a C diminished or a crotchet from a quaver. You know, I don't know. So he said, what I want you to do is disguise the piano riff and can you come up, feature some woodwinds? I'd like you to book some woodwinds. So I said, okay, I'll see what I can do. Well, I have actually got an oboe sound here, which I can come up with. It won't take me a moment. There it is. I came up with this. And Rod said, I love it. So I said, right, well, we better book some musicians. Now, I then rang a, let me get back to my piano sound. There we are. I rang round. I said, okay, I want to book a string quartet, a French horn. And I came up with all these, and Rod was very impressed. And I thought, but God, I don't, who's going to write them parts for them? Well, I phoned up about 10 different arrangers. Any chance of getting over here tonight for a session that's at 10 o'clock tomorrow? Not a chance, mate, not a chance. Finally, a guy called Pete Moss, which is always a funny name, I think. Think about it, Pete and Moss. He said, but I do know a guy, a violinist in the London Philharmonic Orchestra who's looking for work. And here's his phone number. You've got to pay his cab from Muswell Hill. And I said, no problem. And I got through. I said, hello, are you Jack Albridge or whatever his name is? I've forgotten his name. Yeah. I said, I'll pay your cab. Can you come over to Marble Arch? I've got some parts. You've got to have them all written by tomorrow morning. So I gave him all these parts. Or I said, look. And he said, you know, is that going to be a dotted minim or a quaver? I said, I couldn't tell you, but it goes like that. So we got through it eventually. At 5 a.m, he went home. I paid for his cab back to Muswell Hill. 10 o'clock, bleary-eyed, we showed up in the studio. The Faces, as it then became, well, it wasn't then the Faces, Ronnie Wood on bass, me on piano, Ian McClagan on organ, Mick Waller on drum, Rod singing live with a string quartet over there. We came up with the arrangement. I wasn't producing him then. The producer, a guy called Lou Reisner, said, I'll give you one take. Would you believe one take? And that's all he did. That was on his first solo album. It sold 700 copies around the world. Nobody had heard of Rod Stewart then. It was called An Old Raincoat Never Lets You Down. This is 2 years before Maggie May, remember? Anyway, so I've given you the background. Then 45 years later, the Stereophonics cover the same song. And the same week as they do it, Ricky Gervais selects the same song as the theme song from The Office. So wasn't I lucky? Yes, I was. Here's the composer's version. And then we'll take a little break. Ever seen a blind man cross the road, trying to make the other side? Ever seen a young girl growing old, trying to make herself a bride? So what becomes of you, my love, when they have finally stripped you of the handbags and the glad rags that your granddad to sweat so you could buy? Now once I was a young man and I thought all I had to do was smile. Yeah, you were still a young girl. Thank you. take a song of sixpence for your say. I'm gonna take a bottle for a ride, yeah. For a 20 blackbirds and a cake. See you a bit later in part two.